This is part 25 of Azure tutorial. In this video, we'll discuss how to push changes, that is both code and database changes, and update web application that is already deployed in Azure. So basically, we want to keep the build on my local machine in sync with the build that is already deployed in Azure. To migrate local database changes to Azure SQL database, we are going to use Entity Framework Code First Migrations. If you're new to Entity Framework Code First Migrations, we discuss them in part 50 of ASP.NET Core tutorial. I'll have the link available in the description of this video. Now, let's take a look at the current state of our web application, both on my local machine and the build that is already deployed in Azure. If you have been following along with this course, we have a web application that displays inspirational codes. As you can see from the URL, at the moment, this web application is running on my local machine, and these codes that we see on this page are coming from a SQL Server database. So if we take a look at SQL Server Management Studio, notice in the Object Explorer at the top, we are connected to SQL Server LocalDB on my local development machine. We can say that by looking at the name of the server. So on this server, we have our database, codesDB, and within this database, we've got these two tables, underscore underscore migration history and codes. This codes table contains the list of 5 codes that are displayed by our web application, and here are those 5 codes. And then we did not create this table, underscore underscore migration history, explicitly. Who created it? Well, it's automatically created by Entity Framework to keep track of migrations that are applied to our codesDB database. So here is that table. At the moment, we've got one row here. Notice the name of the migration. It ends with underscore initial create. So this migration is already applied on this codesDB database. Again, if you're new to migrations, we discuss them in detail in part 50 of our ASP.NET Core tutorial. Now, this application, along with the SQL database, is already deployed in Azure. Take a look at the URL here. This application is running in Azure, and the UI looks exactly the same as what we have on our local machine. Now let's compare the databases. So if we take another look at SQL Server Management Studio, notice in the Object Explorer at the bottom here, we are connected to SQL Server in Azure. Again, we can tell that by looking at the name of the server. So the schema of this SQL Server instance in Azure is exactly the same as the schema on SQL Server LocalDB on my local development machine. So notice within the SQL Server in Azure, we have that same codesDB database and those two tables, underscore underscore migration history and codes. And if we take a look at this query window, SQL Query 2, again, when I hover the mouse over this from the tooltip, you can see these two queries are being executed against SQL Server in Azure. And in these two tables, notice we have the same rows as what we have on my local development machine. So the point that I'm trying to make is both the web application itself and the database schema match with what we have on my local development machine and what is deployed in Azure. Now, let's take a look at the enhancements that we want to make to our web application. On the UI, along with the quote text, we also want to display the author name, as you can see right here. Obviously, to be able to do this change, we need author column in the quotes database table. Now, before we make any changes to our web application code, first, let's enable Entity Framework Migrations, because it is these migrations that we are going to use to push database changes from our local development machine to Azure. So, to enable migrations, let's get to Package Manager console in Visual Studio. For that, click on View, Other Windows, and then Package Manager console. Type the command enable hyphen migrations. And to have the commands auto-completed, press the Tab key. Here is the important bit. As the command is being executed, pay attention to Solution Explorer. Notice a new folder with name migrations appeared. And in this folder, we have a file that ends with a name underscore initialcreate.cs. Let's take a look at this file. Notice all this migration is doing is creating this quotes database table on our local database. But if you recollect, within this quotes DB database, we already have the quotes table. And if you take a look at the name of this migration file, it matches with the migration ID that we have in underscore underscore migration history table. So the point that I'm trying to make is this migration is already applied on the database on our local development machine. And the same is true even with Azure. Now, let's see what's going to happen if we try to again apply this migration on our local development machine. For that, let's execute update database command from package manager console vendor. There we go. Command completed. And notice the message that we have here. No pending explicit migrations. Now, let's run the project and see if we have any changes on the UI side. There we go. UI is exactly the same as before, and it makes sense because we haven't really made any change to our application. Now, when we deploy this web application in Azure, we want the entity framework code first migrations to be executed. So we have to configure that. We configure that on the publish page of our project. So right click on the project name and select this option, publish. Click on this edit link and then settings. From this drop-down list here, we need to select our SQL Server instance running in Azure. Notice this last option here. By looking at the icon, we can tell this is our on-premise SQL Server database. So in our case, it is SQL Server LocalDB. Notice when I hover the mouse over this, you can actually see it is SQL Server LocalDB. So this is our local development database. This is not what we want at runtime. We have to select here our SQL Server instance in Azure. And look at this second option here. We have the cloud icon and the database name matches quotes DB. So this is what we want to select, and then make sure you select these two checkboxes as well. We want to execute code first migrations. So let's check that box and then click save and then publish. There we go. Again, even in Azure, from the UI standpoint, there's no change. It's exactly the same as before. Now, let's make the changes. And here's the plan. First, we make both the code and database changes on our local development machine, test the application, and if we are happy with the changes, we will then push them to Azure. So, the first thing that we want to do is add author column to this quotes database table. Since we're using Entity Framework code first approach, all we need to do for that is introduce author property in this quote class. Next, we need to add a new migration that actually adds author column to the database table. So let's get to package manager console and execute this command, add migration, and I named the migration add quote author. There we go. In the migrations folder, we now have a new file for this new migration. And this file is already open within Visual Studio here. And notice all this migration is doing is adding author column to our quotes database table. Now, when we add this new column to this quotes database table, we also have to update the column value to reflect the author name. So we need to issue update statements, and I already have code which does that. Let me paste that right here. As you can see, all we are doing is using an instance of string builder and building our update queries. Basically, we want to update all the 5 existing rows in our quotes database table with author name. And then we're using the SQL method to execute these SQL queries. So let's save our changes, and we want to apply this migration on our local database. So for that, let's get to package manager console and execute update database command. There we go. Migration successfully applied. Let's get to SQL Server Management Studio and execute both these queries against our local SQL Server database. Notice from the migration history table, we can say our second migration add quote author is applied. And if we take a look at the quotes database table, the author column is added and it is also populated with data. Now, all that is left to do is display the author name next to the quote text itself. And we display the quotes using our default web page, default.aspx. So next to the quote text, we want to display the author name. And here is the code for that. all we are doing is binding to the author property. Let's also do the same change in the alternating item template here, and then run our application locally. There we go. On our local machine, we have the changes as expected. Along with the code text itself, we also have the author name displayed. Now, we want to push these changes to Azure. For that, all we need to do is get to the publish window in Visual Studio and then click this publish button. There we go. We see the changes as expected. Now, let's execute both these queries against our SQL Server in Azure. Notice, even the database schema is exactly the same as what we have on our local database. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.